So it's a great pleasure to have Byung Park from Seoul National University, who's going to talk about non-parametric additive regression.
Thank you. So first of all, I would like to thank the program committee for selecting me as an invited speaker in this ICM. I feel very honorable to speak in one of the probability and statistics sessions. So in this presentation, I will talk about additive regression. In statistics, additive regression is known as the simplest structured non-parametric regression technique, letting us to avoid the curse of dimensionality, which we would suffer from with a full dimensional regression technique as the dimension of the covariate increasing. So I have been working on this subject for more than 10 years, and during the course of the study, and Maman in Heidelberg has been the main collaborator. And other collaborators are four of my former PhD students, and these two upper two guys are now in Korea after their postdoc study in Germany. And Jung Han is now in US. He has been working with Hans Müller in UC Davis and starting a new job at UPenn. And Jungmin Jung has just finished his PhD thesis, and he's about to start his postdoc career in Belgium under the supervision of Ingrid van Kalligum. And actually, the second part of this talk is based on his PhD thesis. So let me start, this talk consists of two parts. In the first part, I will give an additive regression technique for Euclidean responses and go through the existing theory of the method. And then in the second part, I will discuss how we extend the method to Hilbertian responses. Okay, so let me start from the general non-parametric regression model with the unspecified but smooth function f and the covariate vector x, which taking values in the d-dimensional unit rectangle, and the error term epsilon I, whose the conditional mean given the covariate vector is 0. So non-parametric regression is to estimate the unknown regression function f using the observation of the covariate vector x and the response variable y. And the main issue here is the intrinsic difficulty that the space of the functions that the true regression function belongs to, I mean the dimension of the space of the regression function is infinite. That means it is larger than the sample size, which is fixed. So there are three common approaches to resolving these difficulties. So one of them is the method of sieves, where one approximates an infinite dimensional model by an increasing sequence of a submodel. And one finds the regression function in the approximating submodel that best fit the data. And another approach is for through penalization for the complexity of functions. And the third one is kernel smoothing technique, where one solves locally finite dimensional problems, which I'm going to focus on this presentation. Okay. So, so there is another type of dimensionality problem in all these approaches. So it concerns the dimension of the covariate now. So for example, if the parameter space is a class of functions with two partial derivatives, then the fastest rate of convergence one can achieve is n to the negative 2 over d plus 4, where d is the dimension of the covariate and n is the sample size. So the rate gets worse as the d increases. So this asymptotic phenomenon actually stems from the data sparsity in high dimension. So which becomes more serious in the practical implementation of those approaches I mentioned. For example, in the case of a kernel smoothing, if we kernel smoothing solving a locally L-dimensional problem, we need a sample size at least L times h to the power of minus d to make the local problem well posed. In the case where L equal to 1, which corresponds to local constant fitting, and if we take a point, H equal to 0.1, what H is actually the side length of a rectangle determining the local area. So if we take H equal 0.1 to make for a certain level of accuracy in the local approximation, it means that we need sample size at least 1,000 when d equals 3 and 1,000,000 for d equals 6 and so on. So this difficulty is called the curse of dimensionality, and people have been working very hard to resolve the difficulty, and one way is to impose a structure on the regression function so that the true regression function can be expressed in terms of lower dimensional component or functions. Okay, so the additive model is the simplest structure, letting us avoid the curse of dimensionality. It is to assume that the regression function f is a sum of univariate function of different covariate. And here, we are for the identifiability of the individual component function, we typically put a constraint, and this is a typical choice. And this sum space is the space where the true regression function in our model belongs to, and these are the spaces for the component functions. Okay, so one way of fitting the additive model is a smooth backfitting technique that Anna Mammen and two other people started nearly 20 years ago. And this technique has been proved very powerful and very successful in practical aspects as well as in theoretical aspects. So the main idea of the technique is this. From this additive model, if we take conditional expectation given j's covariate xj for each j, then we would get this set of estimating equations where pj is the marginal density function of the j's covariate xj, and pjk is the joint density function of xj and sk. So we estimate these joint density and marginal density functions by kernel method. And also, we estimate this marginal regression function by kernel method. Then we end up with this system of integral equations. And the smooth backfitting method is just to solve this system of integral equations and take the solution as an estimator of the regression function. Okay. And for those who are not familiar with the kernel smoothing technique, let me explain briefly how the method works in the case of a local constant approximation. So in kernel smoothing, we first consider a kernel weighting scheme with a bandwidth H here. And we approximate a target function, say G, G here, in a neighborhood of each point X by this kernel weighted average. So we estimate this local approximation. Now it is constant. So the problem is just one-dimensional. We estimate this constant and take that as an estimate of the target function g at the point x. Okay. So in this way, we may convert the original problem of estimating infinite dimensional function to that of locally estimating its finite dimensional approximation. So in the case of estimating a marginal density function of xj, so we first note that pju can be approximated by this kernel weighted average, which turns out to be the expected value of this kernel function for u in a neighborhood of each point xj. So we estimate this local approximation by its empirical version here, and this gives us the estimate of the marginal density function pj at point xj. So an immediate extension of this idea gives us this estimate of a joint density function of the xj and xk, and also this estimate of the joint density function of the whole vector x. Okay, so in the case of estimating marginal regression function, we first note that MJ is just a minimizer of this conditional expectation times PJU. As in the case of estimating density function, we can approximate MJU for U in the neighborhood of each point xj by this expectation of a kernel weight the squared error. And replacing this expectation by its empirical version, it gives us this estimator of the marginal regression function at the point xj, which is called the Nadre-Watson estimate in statistics. So at this point, I should mention that for the smooth repeating method to work, we need to normalize the kernel weight function here so that its integration along the first coordinate equals 1. And this normalization should be differentiated from the typical normalization for bias correction in kernel smoothing theory. For the latter, the integration along the second coordinate equals 1. So they are different. So for the theory of this method, the first question we need to answer is whether this system of equation, integral equation, has a solution. Okay? And if so, whether the solution is unique. And then it turns out that the existence and the uniqueness of the solution of the smooth repeating equation actually hinges on whether the sum space SRP hat is closed or not. This is because solving the smooth repeating equation is actually equivalent to minimizing a strictly convex objective function defined on the sum space. And then the existing theory tells that the projection operators, pi j hat, as defined here, restricted to the space of the component functions for k different from j are all compact, then the sum space is closed. And the existence theory also tells that the kernel of these projection operators, pi j hat, satisfy this the so-called Hilbert-Schmidt condition, then all the projection operators are compact. So this means that whenever this condition holds, then there exists a unique solution of the smooth repeating equation. That's the existing theory for Euclidean responses. And as you can see here, this system of equation does not have an explicit solution, okay? So to compute this one, we need other component estimator. So it does not give us a explicit solution. So we can only realize the solution by an iteration scheme. And this is an obvious iteration scheme. So we start from initial estimators of component functions and update them according to this formula and start the iteration when the difference between the two consecutive updates is smaller than a threshold value. So to get some idea about the convergence of this algorithm, we take note of this expression here. So for this, we think of a linear operator t hat mapping the sum space SRP hat to itself, defined by this successive application of complementing projections. Then we may write the smooth repeating algorithm as a single equation here. In terms of the linear operator t hat and some additive function m tilde defined here, which belongs to the sum space. So it's now clear that the convergence of the smooth repeating algorithm relies on whether the linear operator t hat is a contraction. That means the operator norm is strictly less than 1. Okay. Then the existing theory tells that the projection operators pi j hat restricted to the component function spaces for k different from j are all compact, then it is a contraction. And this one is also implied by Hilbert-Schmidt condition, as we have seen before. So to summarize all this, if the Hilbert-Schmidt condition is satisfied, then there exists the unique solution of the smooth repeating equation, and the smooth repeating algorithm converges to the solution at a geometric speed, because we have a sum number which is less than 1, and we have a power r here. So when r goes to infinity, it goes to 0 at a geometric speed. Okay, so far I discussed the estimation of additive regression function in the sum space. Now for the estimation of the individual component functions, we need to put some constraint. In fact, the true component functions themselves are not identifiable without constraint. So this is a typical choice of constraint, and this is its empirical version. We typically put on the estimators of the component functions. So with this component, with this constraint, each component, each of the true component functions and each estimator are uniquely determined under suitable conditions. And the standard smoothing backfitting theory for Euclidean responses actually established that the estimators of the component functions actually have achieved the optimal univariate rate of convergence as described here, and their distribution converges to normal distribution. Okay, so the main idea of this smooth backfitting technique and theory has been actually extended to more general cases and to more general models by these follow-up studies until recently. So those extensions include to generalized additive models and additive quantile model, and to the case of a varying coefficient model and time dynamic additive model for longitudinal data, and to the case of errors in variables in the covariate, and to additive model for functional data, and to the case of a non-stationary covariate. But all of these have been done for Euclidean responses. Okay, so now I move to the second part of talk. So the results here are new development, and the materials are based on a PhD thesis of one of my students I introduced at the beginning of this talk. So non-parametric regression with non-Euclidean data is one of the main challenges in modern statistics. So examples of non-Euclidean data we often encounter in these days are functional data, density valued data, matrix valued data, simplices. Okay, so all of these new types of data have a inner product structure so that they can be considered as a realization of a random element taking biology in Hilbert space. There have been a few studies dealing with Hilbert channel responses in nonparametric regression, but most of them are for full dimensional regression technique suffering from the curse of dimensionality. No study has been done on structured nonparametric regression, except a few pieces of work, including those given here. These are for functional responses only. And the technique and the theory in these works are essentially the same as in the case of Euclidean responses. They apply the smooth backfitting technique to a functional response in a pointwise manner or to a finite number of singular principal component that live in a Euclidean space, so which have certain drawbacks. The pointwise application actually does not ensure that the estimated trajectory is smooth enough so that the estimated regression function belongs to the space where the true regress function is believed to belong. And the method based on a finite number of principal or singular components enforces on us choosing the number of included components in a working model, which seems, in a theoretical sense, more difficult than the original problem. So in this work, our primary objective is to develop a unified approach to the smooth backfitting methodology for Hilbertian responses that does not have these drawbacks, neither suffers from the curse of dimensionality. So before I go further, let me introduce some of the key terminologies I'm going to use in the second part. So in what follows, H means separable Hilbert space, and here boldface the zero is zero vector, And O plus is not direct sum, but it's, it means vector addition in Hilbert space or Hilbert space. And O dot means scalar multiplication. And these are norm and inner product of the underlying Hilbert space for response variable, response element. And some of our results concerns not only Hilbert space, but also more general Banach space. So we use B to indicate a separable Banach space. And this notation is for the Borel sigma field of the Banach space B. And O minus is the notation for subtraction operation in a Hilbert or Banach space defined by this equation. And B1 less than B2 for two Banach spaces, B1 and B2, means that B1 is closed the subspace of B2. And LB1, B2 is the space of all bounded linear operators mapping B1 to B2. And we simply write LB for the space of all bounded linear operators mapping B to itself. Oops. Okay, so with this notation, we may express an LT model in Hilbertian Hilbert space in this way, where the conditional expectation of the error term given the covariant vector x equal zero, and f zero is a constant in Hilbert space, and fj are now component maps taking values in the Hilbert space. So we consider only the case where the covariant vector x is a finite dimensional random vector. This is because the reason is that the smooth specifying methodology is actually based on integral operators that involve the marginal and joint density functions of the covariate, as we have seen in the case of Euclidean responses. Okay, but distribution on infinite dimensional space do not have density functions because there is no analog of Lebesgue measure on infinite dimensional Banach space. So here are some examples of Hilbert spaces. These two are very well known. And the third one is a space of a simplices. Simplex is a tuple of non-negative numbers adding up to a fixed constant. Okay? So in this case, the vector addition and scalar multiplication can be defined by these two equations. And zero is k-dimensional vector of an equalized component. And the inner product of between two simplices is the average of the product of these two log ratios. Okay, another example is the space of density functions defined on a common support S. So for this space, it's called the Bayes Hilbert space. Okay, so for this space, we first consider the space, so the space of sigma finite measures, which are equivalent to Lebesgue measure, yeah, in this sense. So each element of the space M is represented by its density with respect to Lebesgue measure. Then the space of these density functions that are square log integrable actually does not form a Hilbert space. It does not form a Hilbert space. But if we consider equivalence relation such that two density functions f mu and f nu are equivalent, if one is a constant multiple of the other, then this quotient space, meaning the space of equivalent classes, is actually a Hilbert space. So for this space, the vector addition and the scalar multiplication act on equivalent classes in this way, and zero corresponds to the space of all positive numbers. And the inner product of the two equivalent classes is defined as the limit integral of the product of these two log ratios. Okay? Now, our smooth specifying methodology of estimating entity model involves integration of the component functions or maps of the domain where they are defined, as we have seen in the case of Euclidean responses. Okay, so So now the component maps in the present model actually takes values in Hilbert space, possibly non-Euclidean. So this means that the first thing we have to consider is then a notion of integration that that generalizes the conventional Lebesgue integral. So in mathematics, Bochner integral is named after, I think, of Salomon Bochner. Extend the definition of Lebesgue integral to functions that takes value in Banach space. So we first define mu simple maps here for a measure space G, A, and mu, on which Banach space valued maps are defined. So a Banach space valued map is called mu simple if it is a finite sum of this form, and in that case we define each integral with respect to measure mu as the, this finite sum of mu measures of set AI times Banach constant BI, and then we define strong measurability. So a Banach space valued map M is called strongly measurable if it is measurable with respect to these two sigma fields and its range is separable, okay? And then a strongly measurable map is called the Bochner integrable if its norm is Lebesgue integrable with respect to measure mu. Now, for a Bochner integrable measure map M, there exists a sequence of mu simple maps, Mn, such that M is everywhere limit over Mn and satisfies this unicality. So for such a sequence of mu simple maps, we define the Bochner integral of map M with respect to measure mu as the limit of the sequence of integrals of mu simple maps. So this is the definition of the Bochner integral. Now, the methodology, our methodology and theory actually start from these two propositions. For a strongly measurable map M, they give an integral formula for the expectation of M of G and the conditional expectation of M of G given W in terms of marginal and the joint density functions of the random element G and W. So these are actually very well-known, very familiar in Lebesgue integral theory, but the results in Bochner integrals are very, very new in statistics. Okay. So now I'm going to introduce some relevant spaces for multivariate regression map in our model in taking values in the Hilbert space with a covariate vector X. So this is L2 space called Lebesgue-Bochner space. It is space of strongly measurable maps with this property. And this space L2HP, P as the density function of the covariate vector X, is the space we get if when the space G equals to the d-dimensional unit rectangle and mu equals to the probability measure of a random vector X, and B is a Hilbert space edge. And this space L2HPJ, with the PJ as the marginal density function of XJ, is a subspace of this space, such that all maps in the space depend only on J's coordinate. So they are all univariate maps, actually. And these two spaces are versions of these two we get if we replace P and PJ by their kernel density estimate. Okay, now the space here, those where the true regression map in our present model belongs. So as the space SHP and SHP hat are the spaces of sums of component maps MJ. So at this point, I should mention that, I should stress that we interpret each component map MJ as a multivariate map defined on a d-dimensional rectangle. But depending only, uh, d- depending on only one coordinate, so the summing up these component maps makes sense, okay? And these are the definitions of norms of the space L to HP and L to HP hat. And so as in the case of Euclidean responses, if we take conditional expectation of, on both sides of this additive model, given xj for hj, then we get this set of estimating equations. Now, according to one of the proposition I mentioned earlier, this conditional expectation can be expressed in terms of a Bokun integral that involve marginal and joint density functions of the quadratic xj and xk. So we estimate these densities by the usual kernel density estimator in the standard smooth depthing theory. And we also estimate this marginal regression map by this type of Nadler-Watson kernel estimator. And F0 now by the sample average of the response observation yi. Okay, then we end up with this system of Bokun integral equations, and we try to solve this system of equation subs to this constraint to define our estimate of a regression map and each component. Okay, now this is the iteration scheme to implement the method. So basically this is the same as in the case of Euclidean responses. Now, a natural question here is that how we evaluate these abstractly defined Bokun integrals in practice, okay? So do we have to go through the definitions of Bokun integrals to evaluate this one? But the fresh idea of evaluating these Bokun integrals comes from the fact that for a real valued function g and the Banach constant b, the integration of this term in Bokun sense can be done by first integrating a real valued function g in Lebesgue sense and multiplying the Banach constant b to the Lebesgue integral. Okay? So because of the relation between the two notions of integration, it turns out that we may implement the original iteration of algorithm in Bokun integrals by a simple iteration scheme based on Lebesgue integral. So indeed, if you take this type of a linear estimator as initial estimators with the initial weight wij0, then we may express the Rth updates of the component maps as a linear estimator as well, with weight functions now updated according to this formula, okay? So this means that the task of Bokun smooth depthing iteration is nothing else than to iterate updating the weight function based on Lebesgue integral. So this actually is true because we have a special form of integrand in these Bokun integrals. Okay, this is actually true because b is a Banach constant, not function. Okay, now I'm going to discuss the existence of the Bokun smooth depthing estimator and the convergence of a Bokun smooth depthing algorithm, and the rate of convergence and the asymptotic distribution of the Bokun smooth depthing estimator. So as we have seen in the case of Euclidean responses, all these theoretical developments are largely based on the theory of projection operators, now as maps from L to HP hat to L to HPJ hat, okay? So to define projection operator of this kind, the first thing we have to check is whether this space is a closed subspace of this one. And this proposition actually attests that indeed they are. And then we were able to prove that the integral operators pi j hat as defined here, now as maps from here to here, are actually projections. So now again, to get some idea about the convergence of the Bokun smooth depthing algorithm, we take note of these two expressions. Again, we think of a linear operator t hat, now mapping from SHP hat to SHP hat, defined by this successful application of complementing projections. Then we can express each of the Pocono smooth vector equation and the algorithm as a single equation here in terms of a linear operator t hat and some additive function g hat that belongs to the sum space, SHP hat. So now we can see that the existence of the solution of the Pocono smooth vector equation hinges on whether this sum space is closed or not. Or also, we see that the convergence of the Pocono smooth vector algorithm relies on whether the operator norm of t hat is strictly less than one. So in fact, these two requirements are equivalent as this proposition demonstrates. Another equivalent condition is that there exists a positive constant c hat such that for all map m in the sum space, there exists a set of component maps mj adding up to the map m satisfying this inequality that the sum of the scattered norm of mj is less than or equal to c hat times the scattered norm of m. The existing smooth vectoring theory for Euclidean instances actually used the fact that these projection operators restricted to the component function spaces are all compact, which implies both of the requirements. But before our study, the compactness of these projection operators was not known. So it was not known in case H is not a real line or real coordinate spaces. In fact, we proved that these projection operators are compact if H is finite dimensional. But surprisingly, they are non-compact for infinite dimensional Hilbert space. This is a quite new result. So the fact that these projection operators are non-compact for infinite dimensional Hilbert space brings about a major difficulty in establishing the existence of the smooth vectoring estimator and the convergence of the smooth vectoring algorithm. But fortunately we were able to prove this theorem, which tells that the third statement of this equivalent theorem proposition actually holds on the condition S. The condition S is here. I think it's nearly a minimal condition we need. And it's almost the same as the Hilbert-Schmidt condition, okay, here. This is actually, if we assume that P, the marginal density estimator is bounded away from zero, then everything is okay. So the theorem tells that the third statement in the equivalent proposition holds so that the sum space is closed and the linear operator t hat is a contraction. And the first part of this theorem actually then is a direct consequence of this theorem. And the second part tells that if the density estimator p hat is positive on its domain, then each component estimator fj hat is uniquely determined under this constraint. And we note that these two theorems actually are non-asymptotic, holding for given sample size n and for given observations of the covariate vector x and the Hilbertian response y, why that satisfies the condition s. And this is about the convergence of both the smooth vectoring algorithm. So this is also non-asymptotic, and it tells that the Pocono smooth vectoring algorithm converges to the solution at a geometric speed. Okay? And this is an asymptotic version of the previous theorem. And for this, we need some additional condition as stated here. Actually, these are very standard in kernel smoothing theory. So we need some moment condition for the response element. And we assume that P is bounded away from zero and infinity on its domain. And the joint density PJK are continuous on their domains. And K is Lipschitz continuous and satisfies this inequality. And each band is goes to zero, but not too fast so that this condition holds. Okay. So these are very standard in kernel smoothing theory. And then for the rate of convergence result, we assume that this condition holds. And these are also standard in existing smooth spectrum theory for Euclidean responses, except C2 here. In C2, we replace the usual differentiability for real vector function by fresh differentiability for Hilbertian maps. That's all. So then we get this theorem. So this theorem tells that our estimators of the component maps achieve the optimal univariate rate of convergence in a pointwise sense and in L2 and in L infinity. And then for the asymptotic distribution of the Bochner smooth spectrum estimator, we make further assumptions as given here. So now we assume that the conditional covariance operators of the error term, given each covariate, is continuous on the domain of the covariate. And we assume also that the joint density function has bounded partial derivatives. And these are the definitions of a Gaussian random element. I think you know this one, so I skip that. And then we prove that the distribution of the estimated component maps converges to the distribution of independent Gaussian random element as described here. Okay. So I think I ran out of time, so I just want to conclude my talk by giving you a real data example. Okay. So the data set we analyze in this example is a set of daily temperatures measured at 35 different locations of Canada, averaged over 35 years from 1960 to 1994. And in this example, we took latitude and longitude as a covariate vector, and we compared our approach with others in terms of this average scatter prediction error, as defined here. So here, yi hat minus I is a prediction of yi based on the sample without the i's observation. Okay. And also in terms of fractal dimension is a measure of smoothness of the curves and surfaces. It takes values between 1 and 2, and 1 corresponding to perfect smooth, and 2 corresponding to extreme wiggle. And here are the results. And this table and this figure shows that our approach is performing better than other approaches in terms of prediction accuracy here. So ours is the best one. Point-wise application of smooth spectrum is the next one, and so on, okay? And ours is better than the point-wise application of smooth spectrum in terms of smoothness of the estimated curves. So you can see these pictures that this is smoother than this one. So this one is obtained by application by applying the smooth spectrum technique point-wise to response, the functional responses. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much for attending to this, my talk.
So I guess at this time of day, we don't have time or energy for many questions, but nevertheless, if there are questions. No? Okay. Yeah, maybe there's one.
The smoothing parameters in your real data example.
Can you repeat the question?
Smoothing parameters set in the real data example.
I think he's asking what the smoothing parameters, how they are in your example.
How I select the smoothing parameter?
In your example.
we chose that one by cross-validation, actually. Yeah. So maybe some, actually this was done by my students, so I, maybe she applied some kind of a K-fold cross-validation.
Okay, so thank you very much.
Thank you.